But I'm not entirely surprised to see what they've done. I mean, the Seattle Police Officers Guild and most police officers' guild, unfortunately, throughout the nation, are now extremely reactionary and right-wing. And so it should not surprise us in any way that they are using this kind of inflammatory rhetoric. Just wanted to be clear, in that commercial that they're circulating, they have taken our comments out of context. We were talking about the rotten system of capitalism, and absolutely, as a socialist, I'm unapologetically fighting to end capitalism and for a fundamentally different kind of society, but so are a lot of other people. And in fact, it is through the experience of fighting for reforms under capitalism that, in fact, a lot of young people end up concluding that actually the system is simply not working for us and we need a fundamental shift. But that's something to be proud of, not to be apologetic about.
All right, and you know, next up big, the city council votes on defund on August 3rd. You know, what do you have any predictions as to how that's going to turn out? What's the momentum looking like around defund? Is it something that could actually become a reality in Seattle?
I think whether something becomes a reality or not really is always a calculus of balance of social forces. You know, for example, we won the Amazon tax just a few weeks ago because we had such a powerful movement that despite having billionaires and their political establishment completely opposed to any kind of progressive taxes on them so we can fund housing and services, we were able to overcome their opposition because we had a really democratically organized movement that met in action conferences. We concretely collected 30,000 signatures for the Tax Amazon Ballot Initiative, which then became a concrete threat to big business. And they publicly admitted, actually, that they finally conceded to a tax on to a council vote because they were afraid of something bigger passing at the ballot. And I have to say, we would not have won this without the George Floyd protests as well, because it was at those protest movement actions that we were able to collect those signatures, because ordinary people get it. They get that the fight against police violence is also tied to the fight for economic justice, and big business absolutely should be taxed, because who suffers through regressive taxation the most? It's black and brown working class people. So people were making those connections, and that's why we won. The reason I'm mentioning that is because it's the same calculus of the balance of forces that will apply to whether we win defund by 50% at least, and how we win it, what we win, and so on. And so right now I would say the movement is absolutely unrelenting, which is important. This is going to be the key backbone of whether we win or not. I have to say, already the movement has won success by forcing 7 of the 9 council members to publicly promise that they will support defund by 50%, but now the battle lies in not those public promises, but whether those promises translate into 50% defunding right now for this year's remaining budget. And unfortunately, so far my office is the only office that has put forward a concrete number. You know, the rest of the year's budget for the SPD is like August to December for 2020 is $85 million, according to us. And we know that legally this can be done. Like in August, the council can take a vote to cut $85 million from SPD and invest in black and brown working class communities. People can look at our infographic. We have a detailed proposal for where that money should go. It should go into black and brown communities who are suffering, including housing, community-based organizations, and many other proposals. And I welcome council members that if they don't like this proposal and they have a better proposal, that's great. Let's look at that. But let's not delay defunding by $85 million.